Good afternoon. Welcome to the New America Foundation. My name is Peter Bergen. I run the National Security Program here. It's with a lot of pleasure that I get to welcome our distinguished speakers and also our guests and our C-SPAN viewers. Today we're going to be talking about, well, it was pretty prompted by an article in Democracy Magazine by Heather Hulbert, which is called Battlefield Earth. And really, today we're going to be examining the question of, you know, to what extent the United States should engage in essentially an open-ended war, both in time and space. As everybody knows, the authorization for the use of military force was signed shortly after 9/11. Nobody who voted for it anticipated that it would basically authorize the longest war in American history, and a war that is also being conducted in places like Pakistan, Somalia, Yemen, Libya. Indeed, because if you remember Al Libby, who was basically picked up on the streets of Tripoli in October, that was under the auspices of the authorization for use of military force. And there may be things that we don't even know are being authorized by this act. So we have a very distinguished panel to discuss these issues with us today. Heather, who is sitting here, the only female, so fairly obviously it's Heather.
We try to make it easy for you.
Has had a very distinguished career in government, at the White House, at the State Department, working on the Hill. She ran the National Security Network. She's now a senior advisor there. And she will speak first, followed by Benjamin Wittes, who is well known as the editor-in-chief of the Lawfare blog. He works at Brookings. He's the author of a number of books that examine the legal issues that come out of the sort of post 9/11 world. And finally, not least, Micah Zenko, who has had a distinguished career, worked at Kennedy School for many years. He worked at Brookings. He worked at the State Department's Office of Policy Planning. He's now at Council on Foreign Relations. He's arguably, in fact, probably is, the nation's leading expert on drones, which of course are part of this story. So we'll start with Heather.
Thanks, Peter. And I want to start by thanking Democracy Journal and Albert Ventura, who's here representing them, for having believed me when I told them 6 months ago that this incredibly arcane subject would fill a room, would drive clicks to the magazine, and would be interesting and important. And also just to recognize the amount of work New America has done on what it is that's being done in our name under the AUMF. And really, Peter, without the work that you and your colleagues have done, it would be much, much harder to have any conversation about this subject at all. So why would you all come here, and why would we have a conversation today talking about this obscure acronymed law? After all, this week, the president is going to make a much anticipated statement about surveillance reform, which has been for the last few months the hot topic in counterterrorism and associated activities. We haven't talked so much about this issue. And indeed, the three of us were just thinking we can't remember a panel on this subject having been held in at least 6 months. So why are you here? Why does this matter? Why is this a set of acronyms that we have to know something about? The answer I want to give to that, and the answer that the rest of our panel really incarnates, is that both from a legal perspective and from a policy perspective, the fact that we are at war, and whatever the heck it is, wherever the heck it is, we're at war, defines the parameters, the shape of so much of what's happening in our national security policy and indeed in our national life. Even the NSA surveillance controversy, the legitimation of that actually has been traced by the previous administration and not, I believe, repudiated by this administration back to the AUMF, which makes particularly interesting the recent New America report saying that Peter and his colleagues were unable to find concrete evidence that the NSA surveillance of metadata had resulted in an appreciable impact on foiling terrorist plots. So we have this set of legal implications, which if you're an institutionalist, if you care about, oh, little things like the Constitution or the balance of power, is an enormous deal. But you also have this question of, is war footing, are the activities associated with war, the right way to counterterrorism, and are they the most effective way? And the fascinating thing about this to me as a policy geek and a government geek is that the effectiveness conversation is the one we're not having. That you have a report come out saying, actually, perhaps surveillance doesn't help. Perhaps that kind of metadata is not indeed as key a factor in preventing terrorism. You have someone like Danny Blair, the admiral and former senior intelligence official, say, you know, all the effort we put into coordinating military and intelligence activities with Pakistan is getting in the way of the longer term activities, which are actually much more important to solve our terrorism problem in Pakistan. You have commanding general in Afghanistan after commanding general in Afghanistan say, we cannot drone our way to victory. You have the President of the United States say, this war, like all wars, must end. Yet, this war shows no sign of ending. We face this fascinating turning point this year. So the first question you would want to ask is, actually, what is this war that we're fighting under the 2001 authorization for use of military force passed 7 days after the attacks on 9/11? Obviously, there's the ground conflict in Afghanistan. Combat operations there will end in December, the president has said. So what do we know about what else is happening? Well, from official government sources, we really hardly know anything. We have never seen an official government accounting of how many targeted killings or drone strikes there are, where they've been carried out, who the targets were, how many targets killed, how many civilian casualties, what the intentions were, what the effects were. We, those of us out here in the unclassified universe, don't know any of this. Many of our elected representatives don't know any of it either. A few of our elected representatives, the so-called Gang of Eight, leadership and senior intel members, know quite a bit of it, but we don't know what they know because they can't tell us. And so we, as a society, and even our elected representatives, are simply unable to sit up here and say to you, this is working, it's not working, this is the right approach, this is the wrong approach. What we think we know, thanks to the work of New America and a number of other organizations that have worked very hard to gather up this data, is that you had an aggressive expansion of a targeted killing program aimed at both top alleged terrorists and lower level folks, but which seems to have peaked in 2010 and started to decline again. Similarly, you seem to have had over that period a dramatic decline in the numbers and proportion of civilian casualties or collateral damage in such raids. And particularly in the last year, you seem to have a turning away from targeted killing towards more interest in the kind of capture that you saw with al-Libi, as Peter referenced, in the Libya operation last fall, and that may have been part of the aborted raid in Somalia carried out at the same time, although there again, all we know is that there was an aborted raid in Somalia. So it's very difficult to say, and most reputable counterterrorism analysts will not get up and blanket say, this works, it's a great program, this doesn't work, it's a terrible program, because you can't reckon the costs one way or the other. From the point of view of a legal institutionalist argument, if the Constitution says, and it does pretty clearly, that it's Congress's job to declare war, how does Congress think about whether this is a war that it wants to be in or not? How does Congress make up its mind? How do those members of Congress who aren't getting the intel information make up their minds? How do we, as citizens, make up our minds about whether this is an effective way to keep us safe and whether the trade-offs that it poses between how we define our values and constitutional norms as Americans and how that is part of our global power and what keeps us safe against the convenience of getting rid of someone, not just convenience, but safety today or tomorrow who might be threatening us today or tomorrow. So the first step here, and the interesting thing, as we'll see, is this is both broadly agreed and has very little prospect of happening, that there needs to be a much greater understanding of what it is that the government is doing and what it believes the justifications for doing it are. Last year, we learned, because of the leak of a memo from the Justice Department, that, in fact, And then we've subsequently heard in public speeches as well, the administration has three different justifications for undertaking targeted killing or other acts involving the use of force overseas. And one is to invoke the 2001 authorization for use of military force against Al-Qaeda, against groups or individuals or states that planned, carried out, or harbored those who planned or carried out the 9/11 attacks, or associated forces. And here we start to get into some iffy definitional questions. And having worked in the Clinton White House, I always have to promise not to make "it depends what the meaning of is" jokes are. But it depends what the meaning of associated forces is. And then you get into justification number two. The U.S. Constitution says that the president may use force without asking Congress first to defend against imminent threats. So it depends what your definition of imminent is. And there's a fabulous section in this leaked memo which talks about imminent as not really meaning imminent in the way that I understand it, as in imminently Peter is going to tell me to stop talking and let someone else speak, but imminently in the sense of, well, if we get to the point where it actually is imminent and we didn't do something about it when we could have done something about it, then the moment where we could have done something about it counts as imminent. Now, that's an interesting definition of imminent, and I'm not a lawyer. But to what level do we, the American people, or at least our elected representatives, need to understand that? Justification number three is that international humanitarian law says that states may use force in self-defense. But what constitutes self-defense? If ISIS in Iraq is threatening the Iraqi state, and Iraq is a partner of ours, is a state that we have agreements with, but not a treaty ally, does that constitute self-defense? If we know about an Al-Qaeda attack imminent, not against the US, but against a NATO ally, does that count as self-defense? If we know about an attack on a shopping mall where Americans might be targets, does that count as self-defense? And those are all really hard questions that there aren't flip easy answers to. And anyone who tells you, well, the obvious answer is X or the obvious answer is Y, that's just wrong. But what we do know as a society is that at the moment, we don't understand how those decisions are being made. And either you basically trust this administration and wonder how the decisions would be made under another administration, or you basically don't trust this administration and don't like the idea that they're making decisions without oversight. And either way, you might come out with the idea that, completely apart from your views on the actual legality, morality, wisdom of any of the elements that make up what we're doing under the AUMF, it's time for a review. Now, here we come to the fun of American politics. And when I started working on the piece, the great minds at Democracy were very keen to draw a comparison to the 1970s and the great national security reforms that took place then. And I think it's worth highlighting what's similar and what's different about the great reforms of the 1970s. And first, you had just come through a war into which Americans had been drafted and in which hundreds of thousands of American lives had been lost. Second, you had a continuing string of embarrassing intel revelations, including, for those of us not old enough to remember this, that the CIA had stockpiled enough toxin to assassinate thousands of world leaders. You had a degree, I don't want to exaggerate this, I don't want to say that the 1970s were some sort of halcyon moment, but there was a degree of partisan comedy around these issues. So it was possible to have a debate and to formulate reforms like the War Powers Act that commanded some support, although not a lot of support, and they were very controversial and considered very watered down by both parties in Congress. The last point that we had in the 70s that we don't have now is that within each party, or more so in the Republicans perhaps, but you had something of a coherent idea about what each party stood for in terms of what American national security should be and how it should be secured, and you had a degree of party discipline. The fascinating thing that you see as you're heading into 2014 and thinking about the politics of these issues is the biggest debates about what to do about the AUMF are not between Republicans and Democrats, but they're among Republicans. They're between Rand Paul, who wants the president to have to come back to Congress anytime he wants to use force against any terrorist group, and Lindsey Graham, who says, we are at war, the earth is the battlefield, and the president should be taking the fight to the battlefield, the whole earth. And basically, you can fit every Democrat within that continuum. So when you have one party that really truly has, and you know, not just among sort of random people in the party, you have Rand Paul and Chris Christie fighting about in public about what are adequate and appropriate counterterrorism measures, two of the most talked about possible presidential nominees. So at the most profound level in the Republican Party, you don't have agreement about what our counterterrorism strategy is or should be. And in that situation, it's very difficult to be part of a well thought out reform process. On the Democratic side, you have the fact that your party is in power and you don't want to embarrass your president and you have a lot of other things on your plate. And you have this White House saying, and frankly, anyone who's watched Congress in the past 6 months with some justification, well, yes, as constitutional lawyers, it would be much better if Congress fixed this, but we don't trust you guys to do it right. You know, if you can't deal with the debt ceiling, if you can't deal with the budget, how can we trust you to deal with the power of war? So we're in this odd moment that U.S. combat troops will leave Afghanistan in December 2014. The war that Americans thought we were signing up to fight will end. This authorization, in all likelihood, although there is a repeal bill introduced in the House by Representative Adam Schiff and a proposal being talked about on the Senate side floated by Senator Corker, in all likelihood, nothing will happen and we will enter 2015 with this sort of oddly outdated authorization to fight a war against a group of people who, with really one major exception, are all dead or in custody, and their successors, associates, ill-defined. This, most people believe that this is legally okay. Obviously, from a policy and propaganda point of view, it's a little dubious. There is the interesting question of whether you're still allowed to hold prisoners at Guantanamo after you are no longer fighting the war which you were authorized to fight. Now, after World War II, there was a wind down period of some years. This doesn't mean on January 1st the gates need to pop open, but it becomes harder and harder, and with due deference to the legal questions, it becomes harder and harder in the court of public opinion to explain what it is that we're doing and why we're doing it. And that ultimately, the biggest reason to look hard at this issue and to have conversations like this and lots more of these conversations in 2014 is frankly not because of the institutionalist concerns, not because of the balance of power between executive and legislative, not even because of human rights concerns, but because if your goal is to defeat terrorism, and if you have a long-range strategy that depends on fewer people in targeted countries taking up terrorist tactics, you have to be able to explain what you're doing and how you're on their side. And a war which is sort of a war, sort of against you, sort of not against you, we're not going to tell you what we're doing, we can't really tell you why your neighbor's house got blown up, and we can't have an honest discussion, we can have a clear discussion, we can only have a super propagandized discussion about who was killed, who wasn't killed, is, from an effectiveness point of view, a problem. So the challenge in 2014, in my view, and I'm actually hoping to pick a fight a little bit with the panel, is actually not to get wrapped up in War Powers Act reform or in, you know, sort of how many senators on what day can bar naming who as a terrorist group. But it is to have a national elite conversation, a national public conversation about what it is we want to do to deal with the post-post 9/11 problem of terrorism and what authorities a president, any president, this president, the next president, needs to counter them, how we enact those in a way that that uses our legal system and uses our legal system, our military, and all of the frankly longer term and much more important diplomatic, economic, cultural aspects of counterterrorism policy as all working together to make sure that we keep going forward and frankly don't get stuck not just in the name of endless war, but the actual kinds of casualties and horrors of the war that we saw in the last decade and don't want to see again. Thanks.
Thank you, Heather. That was brilliant. Ben.
So I have a bit of a cough, and so if I burst out coughing, please ascribe no content to that in any political direction. So Peter asked me to give a sort of overview of the sort of legal issues surrounding the AUMF in 15 minutes, which is a bit of a project. So I'm going to just try to speak really quickly. About a year ago, three colleagues and I, Jack Goldsmith, Matt Waxman, and Bobby Chesney, sat down and thought we would rewrite the AUMF. And the idea here was that we were more than 10 years out of 9/11. The AUMF is an instrument that is very focused on a response to 9/11. And we were fighting a conflict that no longer involved groups that even existed at the time of 9/11, though a lot of them had embraced the name Al-Qaeda in various parts of the world. And so we thought, you know, if you were a lawyer in the executive branch or in the legislative branch and you were concerned with what I think of as sort of basic constitutional hygiene, and you were committed to having an authorizing document for this conflict, it would be better, not to say what we were doing was illegal or improper, but you would prefer to be operating on the basis of an instrument that describes the conflict you were fighting, rather than the conflict that you were fighting 10 years earlier or that you thought 10 years earlier that you might be fighting. And so we tried to sit down and imagine what would a Congress that wanted to A, authorize, B, limit, and C, define the scope of the conflict that we were actually engaged in, what would that Congress actually write? And we wrote a sort of an options paper with some choices, which I'm happy to discuss in the Q&A the details of to the extent you all want to. And this provoked, we released it, I think, in February of last year, and it provoked a pretty raging debate in the sort of legal circles that work on the sort of law of the conflict for a period of about 2 months until the president's May 23rd speech at the National Defense University. And in that speech, the president said, as Heather quoted, that this war, like all wars, must end. And as part of his conception of the end of the war, he announced very clearly, and I have to say I admire the clarity with which he said this, if not the degree to which I understand quite what he meant. But he said very clearly that he would not sign any law that attempted to expand or continue the AUMF and would work with Congress toward its narrowing and eventual repeal. And so I stand here before you sort of a year after co-writing this paper to say that at least in the short term, we were completely and utterly defeated in our efforts to extend, define, and add definitional contour to the conflict. Which raises the question why this issue is still important, if it is. The president has said he's committed to bringing this war to an end. We're moving people out of Afghanistan over the course of this year. And we have developed a remarkable series of legal fictions that everybody seems, if not content with, more or less comfortable being uncomfortable living under, in which we get to continue the fight even though we're pretending that the war is over. And roughly speaking, those legal fictions work like this. We continue to do drone strikes using in various places in the world, using three basic ideas. One is that forces associated with Al-Qaeda are co-belligerent with Al-Qaeda for purposes of international law. They've joined the fight on the side of Al-Qaeda, and therefore we're entitled to attack them Number two, to the extent that that may not be the case, we're entitled as an independent matter of international law to engage, as Heather said, in self-defense. That means if there's an imminent threat, you can use lethal force to repel it. Now, that's true both for international law purposes and for domestic constitutional law purposes. And we define imminence rather broadly. That's not a new thing in American foreign legal affairs, foreign diplomacy. We've done that, I think, at least since the 80s. But the notion that we use of imminence is one that is relatively capacious. And so number three, ever since the president's speech, we've said we're only going to target people with lethal force when their capture is not feasible. And this puts a similar stress on what the definition of the word feasible is. So you can say by taking a capacious notion of associated forces, a capacious notion of imminence, and a narrow notion of feasible, you're able to do a lot of the things that you want to do, either under the current AUMF, continuing under the AUMF, or even as you move the AUMF towards obsolescence. Now, everybody hates living under the AUMF. There are people who pretend otherwise. But in fact, nobody thinks, almost nobody, thinks that continuing to operate under a more than decade-old instrument that describes a different conflict, this is not a good idea. But we do it anyway, and the reason we do it is that it's everybody's second worst option. From the administration's point of view, there are operations we still need to do, and Heather alluded to this. It's an important tail that wags the dog. There are people at Guantanamo we don't want to release. There are operations that we want to conduct. This is the authorizing document for those operations. It's a real problem to not have an AUMF. But you also want to be the president who's ending wars. You believe in that. That's part of your self-conception. And I think they're, you know, he's entirely sincere about that. And so the best, the least worst option, as Rumsfeld might say, is to continue to rely on the AUMF while promising that you are moving it toward obsolescence. And this is a sort of convenient fiction for the administration, which has even elements of nonfiction associated with it. Importantly, when the Defense Department testifies about what the AUMF allows them to do, they sound very different than the president sounded at the May 23rd speech. And a few weeks before that speech, senior officials of the Pentagon testified before the Senate Armed Services Committee. The document that they described sounded like a human rights group's nightmare of endless war anywhere in the world. Why on the left side, the human rights communities, the AUMF is this horrible, endless war, geographically unlimited, but there's one thing worse than the AUMF, and that's what we proposed, which is codifying some prospective authority that pulls away the fiction that this is winding down to an end. And so, you know, there's a, from the human rights community's point of view, there is actually something worse than the AUMF, which is no AUMF. And from the rights, or sorry, replacing the AUMF. And from the rights point of view, the AUMF, there were a lot of people on the right would agree with, at least the Lindsey Graham right, would agree with people like me in principle that ideally you would want a document that reflects the war we're actually fighting. But here's the problem. Once you open it up, they're afraid you'll limit it. And so everybody has a preferred option. They go in very different directions. But everybody's second worst option is the current status quo. And that is why we are going to continue living under a very old document. And we're going to interpret it at any given moment in time to allow us to do the things that we're doing. Now, if I sound contemptuous of this as a compromise, let me say I am. I think it's a bad, unhygienic, from a constitutional democracy standpoint, way to go about it. But the truth is that, you know, we lost that discussion. And I'm at this point a little bit resigned to the fact that there is not a broad constituency for what I think would be the better, healthier way to do this, which would be to talk about, have a serious conversation like the one this event is about, which is what are the things that we want? Where are the places we want to be fighting a conflict, if any? What are the groups we actually want to think of ourselves at war with? Who do we want to authorize those extraordinary powers against? And what are the mechanisms that we do and don't want to use as a way of defining this? Now, in defense of our political system, let me just say that this is actually a really hard problem. It's hard politically. It's hard in terms of the geopolitics. What are the countries in which you want to think of yourself as in military conflict? Where would you never use military force? What are the groups you think of as just groups that call themselves Al-Qaeda, but really they're just, you know, sort of garden variety terrorists? What are the groups that you really think meaningfully are groups you would want to use military force against? These are very, very hard questions, and that's just the political and strategic side of it. The legal side of it is really hard. If you declare a state of armed conflict legally against certain groups, normally we think of that as an authorization of the use of force as a fairly static instrument. You know, you're authorized to attack Germany and its allies. You're authorized to attack, you know, you can define that pretty easily. If you have a world in which the enemy is ever changing, how do you deal with that legally? This is a very, very hard problem. And one that, you know, there are no perfect answers to. Congress is not so good at really hard problems right now. And, you know, one of the things that's happened in the last year since I worked on this paper was that, you know, Congress couldn't keep the government open, right? Relatively easy problems that you know, are not the sort of thing you would think, they actually don't require huge intellectual investment thought. You know, should you pass an appropriations bill such that the government of the United States doesn't shut down? And I do think that there is, you know, one virtue you can say about the current environment. And I know there are people in the audience who will not see this as a virtue. I flirt with the idea that it's a virtue, is that it is static and self-perpetuating. If you don't do anything legislatively, the authorities persist. And we don't lurch from crisis to crisis, at least in terms of the basic legal authorities. So I would say that in some weird sense, I too see the current situation, as distasteful as I find it, as the second worst option. And I think having, you know, what would be the best option is if we could have a serious discussion about what sort of legal instruments we want to govern, you know, the next 10 years or 5 years of the conflict. What would be the worst option is if we lurched from option to option so that there was the kind of uncertainty in overseas military operations and overseas counterterrorism operations that we have seen in, say, fiscal matters. I'm going to stop there.
Thank you, Ben. That was also brilliant. Micah.
Thank you so much for getting the opportunity to come down and speak to everybody. And I want to thank New America, who has been at the forefront of a lot of these issues for quite a long time, and for the better thoughts from the panelists who went before me. I just had five relatively, quick points which touch upon some of what has already been addressed, but maybe provides it in a slightly new light. You know, one of the things that is worth thinking about is the extent to which the capabilities the United States has to conduct some of these operations has morphed significantly since 9/11. You know, I spend a lot of time talking to people in the military and much fewer people in the intelligence community, but certainly in the military, one of the things that makes them distinctly uncomfortable, among senior officers and general officers is the extent to which the use of military force is an extremely easy thing now. It used to be, there used to be larger logistical, diplomatic, political hurdles to using force, and the use of force is now a pretty easy thing to do. And one of the ways to think about this, my own topic, is just with unmanned aerial vehicles. On 9/11, the United States had 167 drones, three or four of them could drop bombs, period. Just last month, the Defense Department released its latest unmanned aerial systems roadmap. DoD now has 11,000 drones. Somewhere between 350 and 400 of them can drop bombs. And it's important to remember that this capability really emerged, if you go back and read the 9/11 Commission and some of the debates around the ability to find military options to go after Osama bin Laden, was that the Clinton administration, and specifically seniors in the National Security Council, were never comfortable with the options the military came up with. It was using the Northern Alliance. It was a huge logistical footprint. It would cost billions of dollars. You would have to put in an armored division. And they were simply unsatisfied with it. And the solution, which was developed by a small number of people in the Air Force, in the Directorate of Operations, in the Joint Staff, and in the CIA, was to put a missile, an anti-tank helicopter missile, on a platform that was created simply to spy. And what that platform did was it provided three immediate and inherent advantages over all other weapons platforms. One, the ability to persist over a target for much longer periods of time than you can with manned aircraft. The second is the responsiveness, where you have the surveillance and strike platforms mated. And the third, obviously, doesn't put service members or pilots at risk of being captured or killed in hostile environments. And that's a significant change. And subsequently, this capability that was developed to kill one guy has killed something like 3,600 people in non-battlefield settings since the first one on November 3rd, 2002. So there's been something, by my count, about 460 targeted killings. About 99% of them have been simply with drones. And it's important to understand that the drone is the distinct reason for a lot of these. There was, at one time, a strong, enduring normative opinion in the intelligence community and the military that we don't conduct non-battlefield killings of this nature. And it was the position of the U.S. government, in particular, to admonish other governments who did it, specifically the government of Israel. And what was once largely unthinkable among a lot of communities in the U.S. government is now fairly routine. And the number of strikes have come down, as Heather pointed out, at a peak in 2010. And the reason that the number of strikes peak in 2010, in Pakistan specifically, is because they match directly with the surge of U.S. forces. And they also, if you map the number of airstrikes in Afghanistan, which you can find is an unclassified number, they all sort of match the same. The second capability is special operators. And here, Special Operations Command, at one time, I know there was something like 10 Hollywood movies either in theaters or in development of just about the Navy SEALs alone. Special Operations Command has doubled in size. Its budget has more than tripled, now deployed in over 100 countries. Admiral McRaven, the current head of Special Operations Command, has a great line, which is everyone was really attracted to the Osama bin Laden raid, and he said, actually, it wasn't very sexy. It was a very standard raid. We did 11 similar raids that night in Afghanistan. And the ability of special operators combining fusing intelligence collection and going after time-sensitive targets is just changed exponentially. And everyone you talk to in the special operators world will tell you this. I can go in some detail if you're interested about a case study I studied very closely, where it was in the summer of 2002, the Bush administration almost authorized a strike in Kirmal in northern Iraq, which was against where al-Zarqawi, who later became the head of the Sunni terrorist groups in Iraq, was living, and they almost went after him, and it was a complete disaster. I mean, from start to finish, they had months and months to plan, and they never had confidence in the capabilities and the risk associated with the mission. Now, conducting a similar raid would be fairly routine and fairly standard. The third capability is offensive cyber capabilities. And as we learned from one of the recent leaked Edward Snowden documents in 2011, the U.S. conducted 231 offensive cyber capabilities. These are beyond just Stuxnet, but the ability to disraid, disrupt, and destroy an adversary's computer networks. And if you go and reread congressional hearings about what are the situations under which the U.S. will use offensive cyber, what is the strategy, what is the supporting doctrine, what is the understanding for when such missions can be undertaken, nobody seems to know. It's always under development, under review, but not quite there. So it's important to understand that capabilities that were nascent or far less developed on September 14th, when Congress passed the AUMF, are radically transformed and more enhanced and sort of more standardized throughout the U.S. government. The capabilities that did not exist now exist in great abundance. The second issue I would just mention is that people have discussed this. We've never been told who we're at war with. Al-Qaeda and associated forces is sort of a convenient tent, but if you refuse to articulate the scope of who you can go after, it's really hard to assess when the war could end and how well you're doing. There are various bits and pieces for how you could try to figure out who we're at war with. There's the biannual White House War Powers Resolution Report, where they list some countries where military operations occur, but there's a classified annex, apparently more detailed. The State Department has something called the Foreign Terrorist Organization List. Currently, there are 57 groups who are considered foreign terrorist organizations. By my count, something like 9 or 10 of them have been targeted by the United States with lethal force. But we've never been said whether you have to be an FTO, a foreign terrorist organization, to be lawfully targeted. And if you actually look at the State Department and you add how many people are members of those FTOs, it's something like 10,000 different people. So the scope of targeting is quite bigger than you'd think. It wasn't until February 2013 that Senator Ron Wyden, who's a member of the Senate Intelligence Committee, was provided a list of countries where the U.S. uses lethal force. And it wasn't until May 2013 that the Senate Armed Services Committee was told who is directly targeted with lethal force under Title 10 military operations. At a hearing in May, Michael Sheehan, who was at the time the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Special Operations Low Intensity Conflict, he said, "I'm not sure there is a list per se." Levin was then apparently provided some list. That list has never been made public. And when the Pentagon spokesperson was asked why it hasn't been made public, he said, "Doing so would cause serious damage to national security because elements that might be considered associated forces can build credibility by being listed by the U.S. We cannot afford to inflate these organizations by naming them." So it's important to understand that the reason we don't know who we're at war with is because the Pentagon's worried that these groups will brag that they've been named and have been targeted. Which leads, of course, these groups don't need additional fuel for their PR efforts anyways, but this is the official reason why we can't know who we're at war with. The third issue, which people have discussed, is the AUMF is not merely out of date, but it's really deeply misleading. The notion that Al-Qaeda and associated forces, it assumes a sameness to all the scope of targeting. It assumes that individuals targeted in Pakistan are the same as individuals targeted in Yemen, as the same as individuals targeted in Somalia and in Libya. It's really not true at all. That's an immense operational fiction. The types of targeting the U.S. has done in Pakistan, which is primarily about force protection for U.S. individuals deployed in southern Afghanistan, it's primarily about going after individuals who want to attack what they consider the apostate regime in Islamabad, very different from who the U.S. has gone after in Somalia, very different from AQAP elements who have been targeted in Yemen. Even in World War II, Congress declared war against 6 specific states. Everyone, all the Axis, got their own congressional declaration of war. And that only lasted, 5 years. And here you have the situation where we now are 13 years in. Anyone that's an Al-Qaeda and associated force who is explicitly not named is sort of provided under the same umbrella. The final issue is, or one other issue is that another significant shift since 9/11, which is worth considering, is what I consider outsourcing lethality. And these are lethal strikes by other states who receive firepower and intelligence, targeting intelligence from the United States. So since 9/11, the U.S. has provided targeting intelligence for lethal strikes by Pakistan, Turkey, Yemen, Ethiopia, Honduras, Uganda, France, and Iraq, at least. According to State Department reports, a lot of these air strikes result in civilian casualties. It strikes me that if the U.S. is concerned about who it targets with lethal force and what sort of civilian protections they should be provided, it might be worth part of the conversation to think about when the U.S. provides the enabling logistical or intelligence support that allows other countries to kill individuals. Final issue is the politics of this. You know, Obama has said on many different occasions that he wants to engage with Congress and the American people and repeal the AUMF. The problem is that this message has not been received by, the Commander-in-Chief's message hasn't been received by the rest of the U.S. government. At the May hearing with a number of A Pentagon official said, I think the AUMF currently structured works very well for us. Caroline Cross, who is the Consulate General, the lead lawyer at the CIA, in her December congressional hearing, she also said, I believe the AUMF as currently drafted is sufficient, and the interpretation that's been adopted by this administration is a legally available interpretation. So there's no appetite within the individuals who actually conduct the operations for changing the AUMF. And I think unless there is high-level sort of senior demand for it, it's never going to happen, because you have to make the operators comfortable before senior civilian policymakers will have the courage to sort of implement change. I'll just add by or close by noting I was reviewing all of the sort of op-eds and congressional speeches and editorials around the week after 9/11. And one of the things that a lot of constitutional lawyers and military officers were happy with was the narrowness of the congressional mandate that was bestowed on President Bush. That this was, nobody thought at the time that the U.S. would be at war for 13 years or would have used that mandate for 13 years. President Bush, at his great speech he gave at the National Cathedral Prayer Service on the evening that Congress passed the AUMF, he says, this conflict was begun on the timing and terms of others. It will end in a way and at an hour of our choosing. It seems that the discussion about when that hour comes is now ours to have, given that the individuals directly capable for the events of 9/11 are largely no longer with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Micah. Well, Ben, if you were rewriting the AUMF today, because it seems to me that perhaps you and Mike are sort of in agreement, which is what we need is an AUMF that names our enemies specifically. Who would be on the list? I mean, where's the cutoff? So I presume Al-Qaeda would be on the list.
So, look, there's, broadly speaking, there's three ways to do this if you're Congress. One is to make an itemized list of the groups that you want to authorize force against. Now, this is the traditional way to do it, right? You know, you are authorized to use force against the imperial government of Japan. You are authorized to use force against the perpetrators, the individuals, the persons, states, organizations responsible for 9/11 or those that harbored them. You're authorized, so one is to name the target organizations, groups, states, people, specifically. Now, this is impossible to do in the current context because organizations change and they change their names. And the more specifically you name them, the more quickly the instrument becomes useless. And this has been a problem even under the AUMF. It's why the words associated forces, which actually don't appear in the AUMF, have taken on such weight because, you know, a series of organizations have sort of shown up in the conflict that weren't, you know, that aren't obviously described by the original document. So the second option is to describe the category of organization and then leave it to the executive to figure out which organizations at any given moment in time do and don't meet those descriptions.
Well, so as a practical matter, I think there's little debate that Al-Qaeda would be on your list, however it's categorized.
Correct.
So what about a group like Lashkar-e-Taiba, which has killed Americans and actually sought out an American target in Mumbai in 2008? Where would that be on the list?
So look, I mean, I have always refrained from, I'm not an analyst of the groups, I'm not a terrorism expert, and so which groups belong in which category is really frankly beyond my expertise.
Not a hypothetical. This is a group that attacked Americans, specifically sought out an American target overseas. Forget about the name of the group. Let's say that this group was called just We Hate Americans. Would this We Hate Americans group be on your list?
So look, I don't think that hating or targeting Americans is in and of itself enough to justify military conflict. There are a lot of groups in the world that don't like Americans. There are a somewhat smaller subset of groups
that actually do something about that. To me, the what made the AUMF worth passing, look, Hezbollah has targeted Americans.
Yeah, I mean, about 20 years ago, I mean.
Right, but we did not pass an AUMF that said, go, obliterate Hezbollah from the face of the earth in response to that.
30 years ago.
What made Al-Qaeda and what made the AUMF, worthwhile, in my judgment, was a sudden sense that there was a group of global reach that was, at that time, projecting force against us, and that we lacked law enforcement means of confronting because they were camped out in areas of the world in which the writs of our courts don't run, and frankly, the writs of other countries' courts don't run either in any meaningful sense. I think that is reasonably approximates the category of group that I would want to see us continuing to exert military force against.
Micah, what's your view?
I mean, my primary concern is not what legal support the president receives or has to conduct operations, because the president can always, as commander-in-chief, one, he can declare an inherent right to self-defense. Two, he could, for any covert operations, any Title 50 operations, can sign an individual presidential memorandum of notification to conduct any operation and report it to the appropriate committees. He can place, as he did under the Osama bin Laden raid, special mission units from the U.S. military, put them under Title 50 authorities, call it covert. This happens all the time. So the means by which the president can target individuals is pretty limitless. What I'm more interested in is the credibility in assessing the honesty of what the U.S. government is doing. And this gets to the only way you can really do this is to have some sense of who is being targeted, which is why I would be quite happy if the U.S. named the individual groups who are being directly targeted, because it's very difficult to assess effectiveness of strategies unless you do. If it's just always amorphous, shifting target or groups change names, etc., well, then what are we doing? I mean, in 2012, there was 15,000 fatalities from terrorism. 10 private U.S. citizens died from terrorism. Most terrorism has nothing to do with America, nothing. When we see it emerge in areas of North Africa and the Middle East and South Asia, it has nothing to do with us. And we should be limited very narrowly and laser-like on those individuals who do pose a threat to the U.S. homeland and potentially U.S. diplomatic services abroad, but that's very few people.
Peter, if I can jump in and actually try to draw those two together. Ben, you didn't draw the consequences from your criteria, but I will, that if you put criteria that limit it to groups with a global reach and groups that are explicitly aiming at targeting Americans in some kind of large scale, more than targets of opportunity way, that, in my view, eliminates most of the groups that commonly get trotted out now when we get told what a threat resurgent Al-Qaeda-linked terrorism is. And again, it's hard to, I would not like to have this fight with someone who has access to a lot of classified, but we do need people who have that access to be having that discussion on our behalf.
Well, by the way, Heather, I mean, I think you can have that discussion based on public information. Let's say an American is killed in Syria by an Al-Qaeda affiliate, right? This is a public event. Right. So the notion that somehow there's this realm of classified data which prevents us having a serious conference, it's just, that's an analog about the drones,
fair,
right? Drones are public events. A drone attack is a public event.
But actually, I would counter that. And as much as it's a painful tragedy any time an American is killed anywhere in the world, and as someone who travels and has family members who travel, it's something that concerns me greatly. When did one American getting killed somewhere be a reason for our country to go to war? Mm. Is that the definition of war that we as a society want? And if it's not, then you have to base your judgment of groups on something other than they killed one American because, and then that means that they're trying to do what Al-Qaeda was trying to do in 2001 and collapse U.S. society. And, Lashkar-e-Taiba is actually a great example of that, a nasty group that nobody should have any sympathy for, that definitely would like to do harm to any Americans it could easily get its hands on. But do we have any evidence that they are planning to do anything that harms us foundationally as a society? No, we don't.
So there are a couple other confounding variables here. One is that the enemy does get a vote as to whether you are in a conflict with them or not. And, you know, this is not to say that everybody who stands up and says, I'm at war with America, should we, you know, give that vote its due. But there are groups who, when they say it, you know, we've learned from some experience that they mean it. The second thing is that groups that are affiliated meaningfully with groups we are at war with, I mean, the concept of co-belligerence is not without meaning. Now, whether it means as much as the administration has put on it, I will actually defend what the administration has done on that, but I understand it's controversial. Whether or not you would go that far, it surely isn't irrelevant that a group sees itself as a wing of al-Qaeda, that a group has joined, sees itself as having joined the fight in, say, Mali against a government in the banner of al-Qaeda. And so the question of how seriously you take the pronouncements and ambitions of the constituent affiliate groups is a very difficult one in sort of defining what you understand the proper scope of the conflict to
be. If you're rewriting the AUMF, how would you rewrite it?
So you would have to, Congress would have to have a debate and say, we are at war, this is what we are at war with. And I quite like Ben's criteria. Groups with a global reach and an avowed goal of harming core American interests.
Mm-hmm. And who would you put on that list, your list?
I don't know that I would take the list approach at all.
Well, just I'm just asking your opinion. Who should be on that list?
Okay, so core al-Qaeda. Maybe al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And maybe al-Shabaab, based on what we saw about the training in connection with the raid in Kenya, which looked like it had sort of core al-Qaeda quality to it.
And so this gets to Ben's point, which I think is a good one, which is this list would kind of have to evolve because you wouldn't have put Shabaab on this list before the Kenya mall attack.
Right, and I don't know that I would now.
The point is it would be an evolving list, right? Because, and you might also get off it.
Yes.
At a certain point.
Well,
the Hezbollah would have been on it in 1983 and wouldn't be on it today.
This brings you back to this kind of second worst of all possible worlds, because you don't want everybody to sort of stay on. You don't, frankly, want it to be like FISA, where you have the authorities and then you sort of can't go back and revisit, do we need them? You don't want this statute to be in 10 years, just like the statute we have now. So how, given the brokenness of our legislative system, I don't have an answer for how we design a war authority that doesn't become static in exactly the way that you described.
And it raises a bigger issue, which is when are we not at war, you know, just writ large?
Yeah. Well, and this actually, frankly, comes back to the questions that Micah raised, which is as it has become easier and easier and easier to use lethal force, how do we institute real oversight and protection and democratic decision-making about this whole category of near war, which, frankly, we're going to see a lot more near war than we are going to see actual
war. Well, here's a question for all of you then. I mean, one approach you could imagine that is sort of not more than just a U.S. approach is to have some kind of Geneva protocol and or convention about the use of force. That would be, well, obviously drones would be the kind of issue that you'd focus on. But in a sense, it's about in what circumstances can states use violence outside their own borders in a way that we all agree collectively the Geneva Convention has been written on a number of occasions. Would that kind of approach work, and is that a discussion worth having?
It's very much a discussion worth having. There is no substantive agreement, even between the U.S. and its allies, as to the answer to those questions. And I think the likelihood that you could get agreement as to, I mean, it comes back to these questions of how imminent does a threat have to be. There has been some convergence between the United States and the European governments on those questions. There has not been a lot, or there's not been complete convergence, and I think the idea that you could get a written document that even the United States and Europe could agree to is improbable. And what you've seen in our international relations with Pakistan is that there is zero agreement although there are accommodations, but there's no conceptual agreement as to what when you have the authority to use force on the territory of a neutral party.
Yeah, you know, it took 10 years for the international community to agree that the use of to agree that 1925 Convention against the use of chemical weapons after the use during World War I. So the fact that there's going to be disagreements about something isn't necessarily a reason to just say, hey, we shouldn't be having this discussion.
No, I didn't say that. Yeah. I mean, I think it is to the extent that you can, and I think, look, the U.S.-European convergence has been substantial.
What is it? What is the convergence?
So the convergence is the Europeans have come to accept a less temporal understanding of imminence than they had. That is, they've moved toward our view of what imminence means, at least de facto. And we have moved solidly toward the idea that imminence is important. And so the president's May 23rd speech said for the first time, we will only use drone strikes, use lethal force in circumstances of imminent threat, even under the AUMF. And that, now whether he, what that means is a hard question, but at least at the conceptual level, there has been a significant movement both on this side of the Atlantic and on the others, toward a more, I don't want to overstate it, I don't want to say there's a common understanding, there's a more common understanding.
Let me ask a question for everybody, which is, you all know that the Chinese announced about a year ago that they were planning to use an armed drone to kill a notorious drug trafficker. I think he was in Burma, just over the Chinese border. And in the end, they decided to capture him. By the standards that we employ, clearly this would have been a legal strike from the way that we think about threat?
Oh, I think not.
Because?
Generally speaking, the authorizing document for those strikes is an authorization for the use of military force, which we contend is international law compliant. And as I understand the Chinese position toward drug lords, this was a law enforcement operation. We don't really blow people up in law enforcement operations very often.
Really? I mean, doesn't this get to the right to the heart of this whole issue, which is this guy, I think he kidnapped 14 Chinese, sailors. He was more than just a conventional drug trafficker. I mean, isn't this the whole point of the discussion, which is, this is an example of somebody who posed some kind of military threat to the Chinese, in their view. I mean, he was kidnapping their servicemen. And he was outside, it wasn't feasible to capture him, at least initially. I mean, and this gets to the question of this kind of Geneva Convention or protocol idea, which is, surely, since the Chinese have already demonstrated that they may well use basically our own rationale, that we need to have some kind of international rationale here that is agreed to.
Look,
even as complicated as it is.
I don't think the analog would be a Mexican drug cartel type who is not posing an imminent threat to any hostages, but in general poses a significant threat as a general proposition. We don't use drones in those situations. We consider them law enforcement operations. When you take stuff out of the context of the AUMF, you lose a lot of military options. And that's why the question of the scope of the AUMF is actually important.
Understood. But I mean, the drone strikes are not completely dependent on the AUMF. They're also dependent on the Article 2 authorities that the president has, right? So when the AUMF expires, it's not like drone strikes are going to end. Micah, do you have any sort of views on?
Well, I would say I disagree slightly with Ben. Spend a lot of time with European leaders, European capitals, and I haven't seen much convergence. There might be some convergence over imminence, but there is still strong disagreement about what is a direct participant in hostilities and can therefore be lawfully targeted. The issue of signature strikes, in particular, drives EU countries up the wall.
What are signature strikes?
Signature strikes are a targeting criteria that has a long history in the uses of force and actually began under President Bush, but it's targeting individuals who are not who don't appear on a kill list, who aren't known by their names, but through patterns of observable behavior and through intelligence collection appear to be affiliated with the group who was therefore targeted. And it's important to understand the very first targeted killing the U.S. ever did outside of the battlefield in November 2002 in Yemen. There were six individuals in a car. Only one of them, they knew the individual's name. One of them was actually a U.S. citizen, one of the Lackawanna Six. So signature strikes have been with us the whole time. The Obama administration does not acknowledge it conducts them. And there is some rumors that it might have stopped doing them, but they have never publicly acknowledged that they've done them or that they have stopped doing them. And that's really the disagreement. And just to get to the China issue quickly is that the individual who the Chinese would not technically a drone strike, they were going to put munitions or explosives on a remotely piloted aircraft and essentially bomb the little compound he was on. He was eventually captured in Laos, actually. But he had killed Chinese foreign nationals on the Mekong River. He had taken hostages several different times and had killed them. And by the Chinese definition, was conceived of as a continuing imminent threat to Chinese nationals in and out of the waterways of the Mekong River, which come into China. And so they made the contention that he could be lawfully targeted, but they decided to capture him just because he was easily to capture in Laos.
Geneva Protocol, international conventions, norms.
Yeah, so the way I would start that, I mean, just to make explicit something that was implicit, it would be enormously helpful for the U.S. to acknowledge that this was a legitimate and even good subject for international discussion, frankly, because that helps create norms that bind others. And frankly, if the disagreement with the Europeans is still intense in the ways, Micah, that you describe, actually having the Europeans come out and complain loudly in public actually wouldn't be a bad thing in terms of trying to rein in the kind of use that you're concerned about in the Chinese case. So you could imagine starting with series of parallel declarations. These are our principles for how we use unmanned vehicles. These are ours, these are ours, these are ours, and you know, sort of let the marketplace judge, if you will. And there's a great history in arms control and other areas where, as you say, it takes a decade or more to get to an agreement, but you start with this kind of, we're going to let everybody else know.
And agreements happen when the United States loses its monopoly, right? I mean, then it's in our interest to have an agreement. I mean, our monopoly is gone.
Yes.
On armed drones.
Yes.
How many countries do you think have armed drones?
Micah is the expert on that.
Only three states have ever conducted drone strikes outside of their borders. The United States, Israel, and Great Britain has conducted about 400 in Afghanistan. There are barriers to developing the capability, though. It's not as going to be as fast as I think some people imagine, and it's important to understand the sort of architecture of capabilities that allows the U.S. to do strikes at a geographic distance. That's not what you're going to see. People simply don't have the satellite bandwidth to do that.
Which countries do you think, other than the Chinese, probably have a capability or will have a capability shortly? Iran, Russia?
Russia's not till 2020 by their latest. Germany has been claiming since 2011 they were going to buy 16. Now the new defense minister says, I don't know. You look at a lot of the deadlines when people say they're going to have drones, they don't meet them. And then there are a lot of countries who make claims about having drones, like the Iranians. I don't believe half of what they say.
Do you believe the Pakistanis have a drone?
Not armed capabilities, no. But you will see this capability used in regional disputes, because the one thing we learn from the U.S. uses of drones and other states is that they lower the threshold for when civilians will decide to authorize military force. People do things with drones that they would not do with other manned aircraft. They also do things against drones, like Iran does against U.S. predators in the Persian Gulf, where they both try to, there's electronic warfare against U.S. predators in the Persian Gulf all the time. There have been a series of Iranian attempted shootdowns of U.S. Predator drones. They don't do this against manned aircraft. Drones are seen as an acceptable way to sort of poke at the United States, but they don't do it against manned U.S. aircraft. And so drones have the capabilities, when they proliferate widely, to destabilize in ways that other weapons platforms don't.
And just one final question before we open it up. I mean, cyber warfare, there are a lot of sort of analogs, in a sense, to the drone question, right? Because it's sort of, it's relatively easy to do. It's potentially, you know, it lowers the cost of attacking. To what extent, I mean, is there a Geneva Convention on cyber warfare that we need to think about as well?
I mean, if there's one place the U.S., and they're trying to do these track two and track one and a half dialogues with various countries, is what are the rules of the world for acceptable cyber operations? And what is the distinction between essentially preparing the battlefield, which is going into another country's information systems to extract information, and what is actual kinetic-like effects and destroying their computer systems.
Well,
which
was
Tuxnet
an act of offensive warfare, or was it sabotage?
It was an act of offensive warfare against what we would consider something that was a threat against the U.S.
I think it's worth being very skeptical of the idea of an international cyber norms agreement that anybody would follow, precisely because unlike air power, even in the form of unmanned aerial vehicles, cyber operations are done almost exclusively in secret. They're almost always deniable. They're almost always denied, and they're very, very difficult to attribute, and that makes compliance very difficult to contemplate.
Which actually makes it more important that you develop norms on the areas you can develop norms, so that you have even some kind of carryover that says there have to be some limits on what you do with cyber, even if we have no prospect of agreeing what they are.
We're going to open it up for questions. If you have a question, can you raise your hand, wait for the microphone, and identify yourself. We begin with this lady here.
Hi, my name is Sahar Khan, and I'm a doctoral candidate at University of California in Irvine. I've been studying a lot of these groups, and most of these groups have a lot of state support, which we basically call state sponsorship. So I wonder whether reforming the AUMF, what kind of effect would that have on essentially these states that sort of sponsor the groups? And the example that comes to mind is the Haqqani Network. Pakistan was very offended for obvious reasons as to why, when they were designated as a terrorist group. So I'm interested to see your opinion about whether reforming the AUMF or changing it or even leaving it as it is, what kind of effect does that have on diplomatic relations between states that are fighting or that are operating together on counterterrorism strategies? Thanks.
On one level, the answer to that is probably none. The AUMF is a U.S. domestic statute, and under current U.S. law, we can attack groups that we think of as associated with Al-Qaeda, associated forces of Al-Qaeda, and if we reoriented that law so as to provide a different basis for authorization for force against some, all, or even potentially more of those groups, right? You would still have the central architecture of some sort in place, which is a U.S. domestic statute that authorizes the use of force against certain groups, perhaps including groups like the Haqqani Network. And that statute would raise the same concerns with the states in which you're conducting operations as the existing law. With one important caveat, which is that, one of the things that the U.S. AUMF, whatever it is that we're operating under, has to be to avoid further exacerbating relations with certain countries, is arguably, notionally, in fact, really compliant with our international law obligations. And you could imagine a circumstance in which Congress would want to be very aggressive and would pass statutes that would authorize operations that are not, in fact, international law compliant. You could really imagine that, being an irritant in relations with the states in which those operations might take place. With that caveat, I think it probably is not a particularly significant factor one way or the other.
You actually raise a really important point if you turn your question around a little bit. And unfortunately, your question tells us more about the U.S. than it does about what happens next in Pakistan. But one of the reasons that the current dysfunctional situation works well for American policymakers, and one of the other reasons that we have so little information, is that it is quite embarrassing to governments, Pakistan in particular, but not only Pakistan, to acknowledge that these operations are taking place and that they are taking place against entities that, as you say, there are credible allegations that they receive considerable support. So you're, in essence, and probably not just in Pakistan, working with one arm of the government against the other. Now, how do you, as a policy matter, keep that up? If you have to make public, if you have to say in advance, if you have to say why you did it, if you have to say who was targeted, that becomes unbearably embarrassing for a government, and if you're dealing with, say, a weak civilian government, it becomes potentially lethally embarrassing. Now, the last thing to say about that is you can sort of stop the argument there and say, well, that's a good reason that has to remain secret. And, by the way, a reason that some strikes have to remain under the authority of the CIA rather than be moved to the Defense Department, because if they're kept under the authority of the CIA, there's less prospect of there being openness and transparency about them. Or you can say, there's a fundamental flaw in a policy that's dependent on the government of the country where the policy is being carried out not being able to acknowledge that the policy is carried out, and whether or not there are short-term effects, this policy is not going to have the long-term counterterrorism effects that we want. So that's the level of debate that talk about the AUMF ought to bring up, which obviously would have big effects for Pakistan and other societies, but because it is so very awkward and because the short-term concerns are real, I don't know that I think that's going to happen.
When combat operations are over in Afghanistan, as you mentioned, Heather, one of the trickiest items are the 40 prisoners at Guantanamo who are regarded as too dangerous to release, against whom there is no evidence that they've done anything wrong. What would you do about them?
Well, there is a sort of straightforward solution now, if we're not in the realm of politically feasible, but there is a fairly straightforward solution, which is to bring them here, charge the ones that can be charged in civilian courts, as we have done with great success with people like Libby, who's not exactly a nice guy. And then that gets you down to a smaller number than 40, whom you would either have to flat out release or, and this here I come back to my World War II example, which is an interesting one. The U.S. managed apparently to release everyone we held within a few years. Now, the last German POWs were released not free to Germany, but to Britain and France, where apparently they were still doing manual labor well into the 1950s. So there are a variety of clearly legal and more dubious that people at different places along the spectrum might find more or less objectionable places that those folks can go if the administration were given a free hand to dispose of them without the current restrictions, reporting requirements, sort of an overhang from Congress. Now, likelihood of that happening, not huge. So then you're stuck with the counter problem of, do you keep them in the U.S. in some kind of not very legal limbo rather than dispersing them? And that is going to be a fascinating little problem that Congress has taken upon itself and is going to have to resolve in the next year or so.
By the way, should Ansar al-Sharia be on the list, who attacked our consulate or so-called consulate in Benghazi?
I mean, what I would say is, you know, again, I'm not in any sense a specialist on any of these groups.
Their actions. I mean, their actions put them on the list?
What I would say is, define your criteria of groups that. Of what the category, what the behavior of groups that you want to authorize force against, and then allow the executive to designate groups that meet those criteria subject to congressional review.
Well, I'm asking you a direct question. Attacking one of our diplomatic facilities, would that get you on your list?
I think that it is always appropriate to use military force to defend your diplomatic facilities. And so I have no problem with the idea that if a group attacks an American consulate, kills the ambassador, you might respond to that, even preemptively respond to that with military force. That doesn't give me a moment's trouble.
So would you be at war with this group, or would you just be responding with military force because you have Marines at this hypothetical diplomatic facility?
I would not pass a specific authorization for the use of military force designated at one group in response to this single attack. Okay. On the other hand, I would have a statute in place that would allow that group's designation to be covered by an existing authorization.
Okay. This gentleman here.
Ken Meyer, Court World Docs. I agree with the young gentleman here that the damaging of the Iranian centrifuges through the Stuxnet virus was an act of war. Was that attack justified or authorized by the AUMF?
The short answer is no.
And nobody would contend it was.
Then somebody authorized it, then violated the Constitution, violated the Congress's monopoly on declaring war. Shouldn't they be prosecuted? And as a follow-up question, is there any sign that, well, the Iranians are supposedly, you would expect them to retaliate, and there was a case of 32,000 computers getting knocked out in Saudi Arabia subsequently that I think a lot of people think was Iran was behind.
Bam.
We get into the situation where we could be at war with Iran, and the American people don't even know they're at war.
I mean, you raise a lot of different issues there. Let me tick off a couple of responses to a couple of them. No conflict with Iran is covered by the existing AUMF. The president has independent authority under the covert action statute, under which I'm fairly certain any such action would have, Stuxnet action that we were involved with would have been taken. It wouldn't have been done pursuant to an AUMF. It would have been done as a covert action.
I think it's worth mentioning in addition, and again, just to get back to the political aspects of this, that the members of Congress who you postulate would feel that their constitutional place was violated would be falling over themselves to approve that particular action, which leads you to this interesting, and you really see this in the history of the War Powers Act, by the way, the only time an administration is pressed to fulfill to the letter what the War Powers Act says is when Congress is controlled by the other party. So our political approach to this question here has been almost always first and foremost about political power and only secondarily about the questions that we're discussing up here. And I think it's just important to have that clear in one's mind.
Right in the back, thank you. And then the other person in back.
Hi, my name's Benjamin Kraut. I'm law and public policy scholar with Temple Law School. Just in terms of thinking about long-term unintended consequences of rewriting a document like the AUMF, do you believe that, or not believe, that it would perhaps encourage a culture at peace with a perpetual state of conflict, as we've kind of seen with the current AUMF? Thank you.
And maybe we get the other gentleman as well, and bunch those two questions together, because we're running a little bit out of time here.
Hi there, Sam Sturgis with McClatchy Newspapers. I was wondering if the panel could comment at all on any specific definitions or recommendations for co-belligerents, you know, whether it's al-Shabaab or ISIS or al-Nusra Front. Is it funding that they're receiving from core al-Qaeda, or is it direct contact on a certain, you know, amount of time that some future legislation would need in order to kind of make this a little more transparent as to who the actual enemy is and who we can actually attack or respond militarily?
Okay, good questions. Unintended consequences and what constitutes a co-belligerent?
So with absolute and utter ignorance about the legal definitions of the term, what I would want to see in co-belligerence is evidence that you have meaningfully and effectively signed up to the global aims of core al-Qaeda. And I'm sure there would be a good sort of legally valid way to do that. In terms of long-term effects, you know, I completely agree with what the questioner said, and it's very difficult to quantify that. You know, we referenced briefly at the beginning, the AUMF is invoked to justify the NSA surveillance, which of course includes things like looking at the correspondence of the leaders of Brazil and Germany, neither of whom, last I checked, is a co-belligerent with al-Qaeda, and indeed in the German case is a co-belligerent with us against al-Qaeda. So you do have this kind of creep, and you have had a creep of authorities like that. Again, it's not only easier to use force for technical reasons, but also easier to use force because we're so afraid of terrorism, because terrorism produced what we saw on 9/11. Unfortunately, we have lost a number of U.S. ambassadors, U.S. diplomatic personnel over time, and we didn't tend in the past to start wars over it. To get back to the question of whether the group that attacked the Benghazi consulate, you know, I mean, in a way, having worked at the State Department, I'd be delighted if we took it more seriously when bad things happened to our diplomats. But it wasn't before 9/11 in the American tradition that we didn't go to war after the Kenya and Tanzania bombing attacks. And so we have drifted, as I said in my presentation, to this mindset where war is the hammer.
a state of war is the hammer, and then whatever the problem is the nail. And terrorism, a very, very serious problem that oftentimes war, this kind of use of force without explanation, without justification, without the full participation of the recipient societies, not necessarily the best tool for. And war, such a potent political tool at home, that we can't have the conversation about what is the smartest way to deal with the group that attacked the Benghazi consulate? What is the smartest way to deal with what's going on in Iraq now? We don't know how to have the conversation without using the paradigms around war, and our political leaders find it very difficult to have that conversation and not recommend tactics that the public recognizes after this decade of everything being framed in terms of war.
And just to follow up on that for you guys, you know, it is inconceivable that everybody's referenced to President Obama's May 23rd speech, in which he said we need to sort of basically end this endless war. It is inconceivable that a first-term president would make that speech, I think, right? Because the political cost, this is something you do in your second term, because the political cost in this country now is saying something that we all know is true, which is this problem has largely been eliminated, are so great. If you know, a consulate is attacked with somebody who one day was part of al-Qaeda in some very loose-knit way, then the political costs are very, very high for saying we should have a discussion about ending or ameliorating this sort of state of permanent war. Is that a sort of legitimate point? Well, that the political, it's very hard to have a real conversation about this politically.
So it is hard to have a political conversation about this politically, but I think for more honorable reasons than that. I think the reason it's hard to have a political conversation about this is that we actually don't fundamentally agree as a society about what the role of, you know, of military force and violence is, and what the weight of our response, what weight we should give to more traditional extraterritorial law enforcement tools, and what weight we should give to military and covert action tools in the conflict. And when you try to define the parameters of the military conflict, you are to a great extent addressing that question, which is is this an extraterritorial set of law enforcement problems where you hold the Article II powers of the president in reserve for exigent circumstances? Or is this fundamentally a military conflict that you use law enforcement as a occasional or even frequent tool of the military struggle? And those are very different models for how you think about it. One way or another, it is a hybrid conflict, but you're addressing what the weight and what the dominant component of it is, and we don't agree on that, and that's why the conversation is very hard to have. And I think that's actually an honorable reason to have trouble having a conversation. I just want to say a brief word on the unintended consequences question. One of the difficulties of our current environment is, you know, and if you think that in the absence of a renewed, revamped, different sort of AUMF, we will drift to something that looks a lot like peace, you feel very differently about that project than if you believe, as I believe, that in the absence of intervening legislation, what you're going to have is a piece of sufficient military muscularity that it looks like unauthorized low intensity conflict over very long periods of time. I think that is I think that's the likely outcome. We're going to have a kind of very militarily active peace over the next period of time, and that it's going to look a lot like war a lot of the time. And the question is, do you want to think of that as something that Congress defines the parameters of, in which case you're in that messy business of potential of authorizing it, and those that will have the unintended or maybe intended consequences of legitimizing it? Or do you want to deny that that's what's happening and let a lot of that legitimacy not happen at the cost of relying to a great extent on Article II inherent authorities? I am in the former camp. I don't think the president should be doing this stuff on his own to the extent that we can avoid it, and I'm willing to get my hands dirty to avoid that. And yes, I acknowledge that my hands would be dirty.
Micah, final.
I'd just say that the words that the president, any president points to justify using military force don't constrain him or her. And if the AUMF is rewritten or not rewritten, it will not make much operational difference in when any president decides to use military force or not. The capabilities exist in great abundance. These are broadly endorsed and supported by the American people. Over 70% of Americans in every poll support all sorts of drone strikes, no matter how you define the scope of targeting. Appetite on Congress for changing this is next to nothing. Oversight of a lot of these sorts of operations is quite minimal. Every president wants maximum authority and minimum oversight, as does this one, as will all future ones. If as citizens you care about these issues, there's a range of things you can do to make your voice heard, and you can try to work with your policymakers to do it. But on the current sort of track, there's a path dependency to this perpetual war.
Well, on that sobering note, I want to thank Micah, Ben, and Heather for an absolutely brilliant presentation. Thank you.